even though she's not my mother, one of my favorite mothers is going to deliver our sermon today. And it's always a reminder of how privileged we are to have you in this community, Tiffany. Ladies and gentlemen, Tiffany Sapp.
Chris nailed that. That was great.
You did a good job.
To play off of the opening words, I come to you today with both an ounce of mother and a couple of pounds of clergy. So thank you for bringing me here today, for letting me come share my journey with you, because it is my journey, and I can only really speak to my journey. I look around and I see a lot of different kinds of moms out there in the world. The new shell-shocked mothers, the stretched-too-thin working moms, the I'm so in love with my child and this is the best thing ever moms, the sweetheart, please don't eat the dog food moms, the confident on the surface but screaming on the inside moms, the biology tells me I'm a dad, but my kid needs a mom, moms. The I have to do this all by myself, moms. The I'm so happy I have kids because now I have an excuse to do all the cool kid stuff again, moms. The I don't know what to do about my teenager moms. The expectant moms. The adoptive moms. The why don't my kids call me moms? The grieving moms, and the grandmoms. And even within this variety, there's a greater variety that makes it really hard to give a Mother's Day talk. The stuff that so many of you guys shared during Joys and Concerns. Chris shared something on Facebook that I want to share with you. It comes from a blogger named Amy Young. And she sensitively connects with the complexity of the human experience on Mother's Day with these words. To those who gave birth this year to their first child, we celebrate with you. To those who lost a child this year, we mourn with you. To those who are in the trenches with little ones every day and wear the badges of food stains, we appreciate you. To those who have experienced loss through miscarriage, failed adoptions, or running away, we mourn with you. To those who walk the hard path of infertility, fraught with pokes, prods, tears, and disappointment, we walk with you. Forgive us when we say foolish things. We do not mean to make this harder than it is. To those who are foster moms, mentor moms, spiritual moms, we need you. To those who have warm and close relationships with your children, we celebrate with you. To those who have disappointment, heartache, and distance with your children, we sit with you. To those who lost their mothers this year, we grieve with you. To those who experienced abuse at the hands of your own mother, we acknowledge your experience. To those who lived through driving tests, medical tests, and the overall testing of motherhood, we are better for having you in our midst. To those who are single and long to be married and mothering your own children, we mourn that life has not turned out the way you longed for it to be. To those who step-parent, we walk with you in these complex paths. To those who envision lavishing love on grandchildren, yet that dream is not to be, we grieve with you. To those who will have emptier nests in the upcoming year, we grieve and rejoice with you. To those who place children up for adoption, we commend you for your selflessness, and we remember how you hold that child in your heart. And to those who are pregnant with new life, both expected and surprising, we anticipate with you. This Mother's Day, we walk with you. Mothering is not for the faint of heart, and we have real warriors in our midst. We remember you. I'm very grateful for those words. It said so much better what I had been struggling to say for weeks now. I struggle with giving this talk because all I have is my perspective, and I fear alienating someone or being irrelevant to over half of my listeners. I mean, in a world where nothing is gender-specific anymore, we have this gender-specific holiday. We have Mother's Day, and then about a month later, we'll have Father's Day. Bridget at least kind of has rejected some of the gender-specific stuff because the flower pot that she made me in preschool, she wants to give to Jay on. So she's at least rejected some of that. And I know, personally, that there have been times in my own life that Mother's Day has been about grief, not about joy. So I want to acknowledge that. So I was tempted, in light of these difficulties, to intellectualize motherhood, to talk about the symbol of mother, the strength, the determination, the unconditional love that dwells within every single one of us, because that is powerful stuff. The mother archetype is so all-encompassing that when you say mother, nobody goes, "What's that?" Mama is one of the first words that most of us learn. Aldous Huxley showed us how messed up the dystopian Brave New World was by telling us about children grown in factories and raised in mass nurseries, a world devoid of mothers. It was one of the worst things he could think of. But symbols, by their nature, are often idealized. So when we talk about the mother within, we're thinking about fiercely protective mother or unconditionally loving mother. Not someone who's exhausted beyond sanity and covered in unidentifiable substances. In the ideal, we lose the sense of the glorious imperfection, the hilarious, messy humanness of it all. I've been learning slowly, even resistantly at times, that while I like to contemplate these almost universal symbols, it's the particulars, it's my own perspective that matters. I am Bridget's mom. If she was here, she'd be like, "This sermon's not about Mother's Day, this sermon's about me." And she would love that. But this is such a rich, deep experience that has molded me more than any other experience in my life. And what I have learned is how absolutely human I am, how much of my ego I have to let go of, and how there are gifts in the present moment if I'm willing to let go and enjoy them and experience them. And I'll tell you what the most human thing in the world is: baby poop. This week I discovered that if you ask a mom for a story about the humanness of motherhood, they're going to tell you about baby poop. Motherhood can be messy, literally and metaphorically. The best one I heard was about a brand new mother who found herself in a public place with 4 different undesirable substances on her at once. But I will spare you the details. I can see some of you being like, "Oh my gosh, how much is she going to talk about this?" Instead, I'm going to tell you about a time that the last time that I brought Bridget to the doctor's office to get her shots, she had to get 4. Yeah, and she's old enough to anticipate them now. Every time we go to the doctor, whether it's her yearly where she's getting a shot or not, she's like, "Mommy, are we going to get shots?" And every other time that I take her and she doesn't have to get shots, I like to be able to say no and have her believe me, which means that when we went to get shots and she said, "Mommy, do I have to get shots?" I had to say, "Yes, you do. But then we're going to go out for pancakes. And after that, we're going to go out for ice cream. And you're not going to have to go to school, and I will do anything I can to please make it through today." So she didn't really care about that because she had to get shots. And she cried. And after it was over and she's crying and I'm holding her, I say, "Just breathe. Just relax and it's going to feel better. It's going to be okay. I love you." So we're going out for pancakes. And in my absent-mindedness, I pull open the door of the IHOP right onto my sandal-clad feet. It hurt so bad. Pain shot through me as several layers of skin were scraped off my toes, and I had to sit on the bench right outside of IHOP and just hurt for several moments. Bridget sits beside me and says in a sweet and, I swear, ironic voice, "Just breathe, Mommy. Try to relax. It's gonna be okay. It's not gonna hurt forever. I love you, Mommy." Thank you, Bridget. Thank you, Bridget. We are gonna be okay. And I was, and she was. I hadn't even remembered this story until my sister had told me a sadder variation on the same theme. Sitting at her computer one night, she was blindsided by the news of the death of a friend. She just stared at the computer in disbelief, and tears poured down her face, and she couldn't hide it from her 10-year-old. Her 10-year-old came up, sat in her lap, asked her what happened, listened sympathetically, and hugged her afterwards. "I'm so sorry your friend died, Mommy." Our children are wise and compassionate. My sister and I contemplated what the point was of these parallel stories that struck us so, and this is what we came up with. It's about allowing our children to see us as people. It's about allowing us to see them as people, too. Sometimes in the day-to-day, we objectify them. But it's also about the vulnerability of letting them see us be human beings. Seeing them as people is hard. Letting them see us as people is even harder. It's like my friend who fretted over calling her adult daughter because she was dealing with a particularly difficult life decision, and my friend didn't have the answer to her daughter's problem and didn't know what to do, how to have this conversation. And it blew her mind when I suggested to her that she maybe could admit to her daughter that she didn't have the right answer here, that it was a tough one. Why is it so hard for us to let our children see us as humans? That we are just doing the best we can without all the answers. The good news is that if we stop trying to fool them, we might get to connect with them even deeper than we already have. Life is filled with opportunities to be human, to be a mess, both literally and figuratively, to not have the answers, to enjoy a deeper connection in the process. To let our children, biological and spiritual, see who we really are. I think we will teach them to learn to love imperfection early, and that maybe we'll all learn to love each other better in the process. One of the best things that my friends can say to me, and some of them say it often, is "you're a mess." It's always said with a loving tone, almost like a benediction. "You're a mess." And there's so much truth in it. I'm a mess. You're a mess. We are all messes. If you are fooled by the thin veneer of competence and competence that I clothe myself with in the morning, then you're not looking at me very closely. And that's okay, because most days I don't look at myself that closely either. More often than not, I fool myself, even when I'm not fooling anybody else. And when my beautifully flawed, human, normal messiness leaks around the edges, it is the one that hugs me and chuckles, "You're a mess," that offers me the acceptance that restores me to my true, "I'm just doing the best I can" self. It's liberating to let yourself be a mess. Karen Mazin Miller is the author of Mama Zen, which Chris read part of the intro to us. She talks about the joys and struggle of motherhood from the perspective of a deeply devoted student of Zen Buddhism. She speaks of those early times of motherhood, where you have absolutely no clue what's going on, are too tired to try to figure it out, and just want to know when you're going to get a shower again. She says this time is a pivotal time for breaking down your ego's desire to control everything around you. Things no longer happen by your schedule or by your will. Just waking up and getting out of bed becomes a spiritual practice. And for me, this calling to surrender your ego, the inevitability that life is going to make you give up your agenda at some point, is what is universalizing about motherhood to me. Even if you don't consider yourself a mother, or if society doesn't consider you a mother, if you have loved so deeply and desperately to experience the shattering of your illusion of control, to know the highs and lows of devotion and exhaustion, then you are a mother in my book. I look around here at the Unitarian Universalist Fellowship of Bay County, and how much has changed in the last few years. Can I get an amen? And I know that there are people here who love this fellowship the way a mother loves a child, because I see the evidence of it around me. There are people who have given so much of themselves, and then given even more because of how this community makes them feel and because of the vision that they have for the future of this place. Contemplate how a mother can spend all day long caring for her child, her baby, and finally get that little bundle of demands into bed and collapse on the couch and say, "Oh, thank goodness." To only hear the cries of need once again an hour or two later. Are you kidding? Depending on the child's developmental place, sometimes that's okay. And Kanofa and Jayon had to kind of do an intervention for me and let me know when that point was for Bridget. But when they're youngest, when they're at their youngest, this is usually not an option. And in those moments, even though you don't want to get up again, even though you might cry or curse, you are going to get up and you are going to pick that baby up because that's what the baby needs, and you're the mother or the father. There are people here who love this fellowship so much that they just keep picking that baby up, even though they don't know where the strength is going to come from. Those are the dark nights. But there are brighter days when steps are taken, when milestones are celebrated, when we hear the treasured words, "I love you," "thank you." We marvel at how far this precious child has come in just a few years, and every step towards independence and the pain of letting go is softened by the joy of seeing the object that you love evolve into something more awesome than you could have ever imagined. Mama Zen reminded me to laugh at myself and maybe at the fingerprints that are on the back of my shirt all day, the peanut butter and other substances that I don't even notice. It's a dance full of stumbles. And we only look like we've mastered it because we wave our hands and go, ta-da, when our falls are the most spectacular. Though it's not our first instinct, we can relax into motherhood with an easy on us, an easy on our child attitude. Whether we are figurative or literal mothers, when we go easy on ourselves and enjoy life with our children, we get to enjoy those present moments right in front of us. Last weekend, Bridget and I were at a celebration of creativity and inspiration with the local pagan community. She had soaked her socks and shoes in the mud in about 5 minutes of being there hunting frogs. but she had resisted the temptation of the kiddie pool much longer. But about 20 minutes before the ritual began, she couldn't resist any longer, and her pants were soaked. I took her to the privacy of my car. I stripped off her pants. I put those on the hood to dry in the sun. I wrapped her up in a purple sarong. Ta-da! Ritual wear! I meant to do that! And she was marvelous during the ritual, running when she was supposed to run, a sheer ball of determination to run the fastest, dancing around the circle and inviting others to join in as if she were the lead priestess. I don't think Rindy minded. But occasionally the sarong would go wonky and I'd see Disney characters on her underwear peeking out. And I'd call her back to me to fix it and then let her go to dance on her merry way again. It was a lovely day. But I knew I had spent too much of my time, energy, and attention on averting a wardrobe malfunction that no one else even noticed or cared about. Parenthood can sometimes be a mind game we play, and at each age, it has its own sets of opportunities to either choose to celebrate or choose to worry. Am I going to focus on how she kept me up all night? Or am I going to allow my attention to be pulled completely into the very first attempts at blowing spit bubbles? Am I going to focus on the seemingly endless struggle of potty training? Or am I going to focus on the little soap operas that she creates with her stuffed animals? Her daddy taught her that. Am I going to focus on her calculating experiments with adult words? Or on the way that she says thank you to every person working in the restaurant at my friend's birthday? Sure, there are hard things to notice and to deal with, and I do those things. But after I've done what I have to do and set her to figuring it out, I want to treasure the good things in my heart instead, not spend all day adjusting a sarong. Karen Miller, our author, puts it this way. This is how it passes. No matter where we are, we think of someplace else. The place after nighttime feedings. The place beyond 12-day diapers. The certain bliss that beckons from a distant shore. This is how we spend our lives. This is how we spend their lives, motoring past milestones as if collecting so many merit badges. And I do this as mother to the RE program now. My future visions of more classrooms, a bigger fenced-in playground, a minister to mentor me, and above all else, more time, can overshadow the delight of the space we have now. The equipment I have now, the support I have now, the time I have now. Don't get me wrong, I want all those things and I want them as soon as possible. But I also want to enjoy now. I want to really dwell in the routine of sitting on those cushions, singing our song, Everyone Belongs. 5 to 15 kids of all ages stretching their hands in the air for their turn to share joys and concerns. I realize that they know something that I often miss, that right now is really awesome. By the time the entirety of my vision comes to pass, some of the kids here right now will have aged out or moved away. Just like by the time Bridget is as self-sufficient as I dream her to be, the hermit crab hunting and the stuffed animal soap operas will be over. Our Mama Zen teacher concludes her story by asking a very significant question. Why not? This question is at the very center of the love and the courage that can make us the best mothers, literally or figuratively, that we can be. It opens us up to the possibilities, and it lets us know that it's okay if we're a mess. It's okay if we haven't figured it all out. My mom did this. She asked why not when her stubborn, uptight, fundamentalist daughter struggled with wanting to be a minister in a belief system that didn't support it. She nudged me toward a BA in religion in a liberal-ish Christian school and said, why not? We believe in our children whether it's our 4-year-old wanting to be a spaceship captain, our teenager wanting to be a minister, or our fellowship taking its faltering baby steps. We trust our children to work it out, even when we have no idea what the future holds. That's when we say, why not? And we enjoy it while we're at it, making the connections we make, laughing at the beautiful, messy humanness of it all. We decide to enjoy the journey of all the bumps and imperfections, because why not? Sometimes it's hard to loosen up, laugh at yourself, enjoy the moment, and say why not when you're so tired and so worried about what might go wrong. You remember my friend with the 4 undesirable substances? When she made it home, messy and exhausted, with a nonplussed 2-week-old, her brother-in-law took one look at her and said, I made lunch and I'm done with my day. Can I please take her for a walk? I've missed her. Help comes when we need it, and it comes even better when we ask for it. And we can make such a difference when we're the one who gets to help. Maybe today your why not is why not ask for help. Maybe today your why not is why not step up and lend a hand. Today my why not is why not enjoy every moment. The messy ones, the I don't know what I'm doing ones, the tired ones, the joyful, precious, I'm never, ever going to see them again ones. Why not? And why not consider who you are as a mom? Maybe the guys feel weird about me asking that. Maybe not. But why not consider how you're a mother? Why not consider what you are devoted to the point of exhaustion? In a minute, we're going to invite the kids out to share flowers with the mothers in this congregation. And I would ask each of you who can connect with the mother within on any level to raise your hand and receive a flower from the kids. But it is your choice. And where you use. So I know there's going to be a few of you who are like, I do not connect with the mother within. And I'm going to be like, that is awesome. That's your journey. But I'm going to go get the kids. Okay. You don't